morning, everyone. We weren't sure if the partial rapture happened or if people heard that we were talking about election today. And so we can see that there are a few empty seats. This is what happens, right, when you put out on Friday what you're talking about on Sunday and it has the word election in it. Now, some of you understand the idea of election as very contentious, and you don't even know anything about church. You just know that when somebody says election, like contention is going to happen, right? And we Christians have taken it to a whole new level with what we're going to talk about today, right? Because every 4 years isn't enough for Christians. We have to fight about it all the time. And so today we're going to talk about this doctrine of election as it comes up in our study in 1 Peter. So if you have a Bible, 1 Peter chapter 1, we're still in verses 1 and 2. And great news, we're going to be there this week, and we're still going to be there again next week. Four sermons for two verses, and this is just because some of you said that I didn't know how to do expositional preaching, and so this is all just to prove you wrong. You will be begging to go back to the survey mode once we're done with this. 3 years in 1 Peter. I'm kind of kidding. So far in our series in 1 Peter, just to kind of catch you up, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1a, we met Peter, an apostle of Christ Jesus, and from Peter in his life, we learn that God does his perfect work through imperfect, flawed but faithful, ordinary, everyday people, and everyone who is an ordinary, everyday, flawed but faithful person said amen to that, right? That God doesn't need superstars to do his work. Thank you, Jesus. Then in verse 1b, we met the elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. And from them, we skipped that word elect just so we could come back to it today. But we learned that we, like Peter's first recipients, are strangers in a strange land. And I said, some of us are stranger than others, but we could all stand to maybe even be a little more strange. We're strangers in a strange land who were scattered to spread the gospel, to share the good news of Jesus. So those words that we looked at last week remind us who we are in relation as Christians, in relation to the world around us. That in relation to the world around us, we are strangers, elect exiles of the dispersion. The next words that Peter is going to tell us who we are in relation to God. And this is important context for our whole discussion this week and next week, is that what Peter is reminding people is who they are in relation not only to the world around them, but who they are in relation to the Lord God Almighty. And so he uses these words, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2. I'll pick up that important word from verse 1. Elect, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ, and for sprinkling with his blood, may grace and peace be multiplied to you. He introduces Trinitarian theology here. We have the Father, we have the Son, we have the Holy Spirit. In addition, there are a couple words that I just read that cause some of you to twitch just a little bit. I didn't even have to look, and I can tell, because when I use the word elect and the word foreknowledge, some of you were kind of doing the twitch thing a little bit. Peter introduces a concept here that has become one of the most hotly contested, one of the most hotly debated theological topics in the history of the entire church. Good news, I'm not going to clear any of it up today. People have been fighting about this since about the 4th or 5th century. And I'm not so naive as to think that I'm going to get up here and introduce some argument and everybody's going to be like, oh, well, that's all figured out. You should write a book and lots of people will buy it. We know that's not going to happen, but my goal is to challenge today, number one, our thinking on this topic, and number two, maybe even more importantly, how we approach people who think differently about this topic. That's where the church has traditionally got it wrong, is how we've approach people with different views on this topic. I will take a stand on this topic. I will give you biblical reasoning behind why I take the stand that I do today. But I want us to make sure that we always think about and approach this with the right attitude. Because as Peter writes this text, he's writing us to remind us who we are. And we all need to be reminded of who we are in relation to the great God of the universe. So we're going to unpack the five facets of election from this passage. Now, I just want to make sure right up front as I get going that you all know that I started this as one sermon on the five facets of election. It will be two sermons on the five facets of election. We will get through one and two today. So when I'm like, 20 minutes into point two and you're like, we've got three left. No, we're just going to do the first two today. And then next week we'll come back and we'll hit the last three, because this is a lot from these couple verses. If I read this morning and you were like, oh man, that's a lot there. Trust me, in studying it, it's a lot there. So it's going to be a two-part sermon. And today I'll introduce the first two facets of election from these verses. And point number one, if you're taking notes, is this. The first facet is this, that the truth of election is biblical. Okay, thank you. No weapons, no ammunition out yet. The truth of election is biblical. And I want to prove that to you so we can all get on the same page and be that same place. So chapter 1, verse 1, fill in the blank with me here. To those who are blank exiles. Everyone say it together. To those who are. Okay, now let's stop for a minute and let's look at our Bibles to make sure this isn't a word that Steve made up. This isn't something that it was a good idea. We're looking at our Bibles, English Standard Version. To those who are. That's not good enough. I feel like I've got the Calvinists on one side and the Arminians on the other side over here. And half of you don't even know what that is yet. Hopefully you will by the end of the day. To those who are, it's a Bible word. I will prove that to you, that this is a Bible word. The word is eklektos in Greek. Eklektos is used in the New Testament related to the saints, the people of God, at least 17 different times. It simply means this, eklektos. It sounds a lot like something we just said. It means elect, or it means chosen. Those are the two ways that it's translated in classical literature, in the Greek version of the Old Testament, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, and in the Greek New Testament, that word means elect or chosen. It's a Bible word. That's the big E on the I chart. And I tell you that because I understand that for many, many people, it's, I believe in election. And for other people, it's, I don't believe in election. To believe in the Bible is to believe in election. I'm not trying to move you to one side or the other yet today, but I do want us to understand that sometimes we fight over things that we haven't thought about. And I need you to see that this is not something that was made up by, a 4th century monk or 5th century monk. Or it wasn't made up by a 16th, 17th century reformer. These guys didn't just like come up with this word and have this idea that, I know, we'll create this evil doctrine and people will get angry about it and it'll split the church. So let's look, as we always want to, at Scripture and how Scripture uses this word. And again, I'm not even trying again to talk about how we fall out on this as much as I am to say that the Bible teaches something about election. Here's some passages. Romans chapter 8, verse 33. By the way, the highlighted words are the ones that are translating that Greek word that I just talked about, okay? Romans 8, 33 says, who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. 2 Timothy 2, 10, therefore I urge everyone for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Titus 1:1, Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the faith of God's elect. This is a Bible word. I'll give you the definition in a minute, and then later we will talk about the controversy and how we interpret and understand it, but it's a Bible word. It's translated elect, but it's also translated chosen, and here are a few of those. Colossians 3:12, put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. And then Paul goes through and gives them things to put on as Christians. But they're God's chosen ones. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. We'll get to that in about 6 months. And it says this, you are a chosen race. Revelation 17, 14, talking about the end times, it says, he is the Lord of lords and King of kings. Those with him are called the chosen and faithful. And then in using the verb, probably the most important text on this is Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. You read this if you did your homework from last week. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and blameless before him. I want you to see that the truth of election, the idea, the concept of election is in fact something that comes from God's word. It comes from the Bible. This is not something that man made up. This isn't an idea that people made up. I'll reference this a few times, but one of the biggest problems that I think that American Christians have with just the concept of chosen or election is the idea of the schoolyard kickball team, right? Well, you look pretty athletic, so I choose you. You look like you don't have a chance to kick that ball. You're out of here, right? We have this like Americanized concept and understanding of choice and choosing things that is far different than what Scripture would lay out. And we'll get into that some more. But here's a definition of, a beginning definition of election is this. Election, as we talk about it in terms of Scripture, is the act of God before the creation of the world in which he chooses some people to be saved. Notice the ellipsis right there. You see that? How you finish that determines where you fall out on election. We'll get into what that means. But a general basic definition of election, as we've seen those Bible words, is the act of God before creation in which he, in fact, chooses some people to be saved. And then the debate would be, if he chooses some to be saved, does that mean he chooses others to be lost? If he chooses some to be saved, is it based solely on his sovereignty, or is it also on their merit and on their faith? And that's where the divide really comes. But theologians down through the years, and good Christians all down through the years that fall on both sides of the election issue, have agreed on this portion of the definition. Some of us have put ourselves in one camp or another camp, and I want you to understand that these camps most often agree on this idea because they open their Bibles and they see whether they're reading the Greek New Testament, eklektos, or whether they're reading an English or a German or a Dutch, whatever Bible that they're reading, they see the word election. And so they agree that this is an act of God before creation, which he chooses some people to be saved. And again, as we get into this, I want to say, like, we try to steer clear of using labels as much as possible. Because what happens when you use a specific label is then you become branded as that particular camp or this particular camp. And we try to be careful of that because we want to take everything back to Scripture. So someone calls themselves a Pelagian or a semi-Pelagian, and you're like, what does that even mean, right? Or somebody calls themselves an Arminian, a free will Arminian, or they call themselves a Wesleyan Arminian, or they call themselves an Amaraldan, or they call that's a four-point Calvinist, by the way, which the Calvinists get really upset if you call yourself a four-point Calvinist. The real Calvinists don't like that. So then you've got the Reformed Calvinists, you've got the hyper-Calvinists, and you've got the Jerks for Jesus, and they're all over the place, okay? And what happens is that we kind of divide over that before we see the truth that these people believe together. And so one of the major proponents of what is called the conditional election view, not the first person to believe, it was a man named Jacob Arminius. Have you heard of Arminius and Arminianism? And many people wrongfully believe that Arminius did not believe in election and did not teach election, and that Calvin came along and taught election. That's actually not true. Arminius said this about election. Arminius, Jacob Arminius, the founder of Arminianism, said, "Election is the decree of God by which of himself, from eternity, he decreed to justify in Christ believers and to accept them unto eternal life." Many of you know that Arminius and Calvin went toe-to-toe with each other. Again, I'll give you some history of that in a minute. Did you know that Calvin would be happy with that entire definition minus one word? There's one word in there that separates these two theological systems that have caused bloodshed and tears and church splits and anger and division. The word is believers. Because conditional election will say that Jesus looked, or that God, the Father, looked down through time and saw who would believe and then elected them. Whereas unconditional election would say something different. My point in showing you this is to help us to see and to understand that the truth of election is actually something that people from both sides of this argument have agreed on for centuries and centuries of history. And this is important because it's going to couch our whole discussion about how we approach this in an important light. There are heresies that have come down through church history, and we fight hard against heresies. As we look at what people have believed together and then what has divided them, it's important for us to see that election, again, the truth of election, is something that we actually see in Scripture and is taught in Scripture, and why I show you those verses. And so, hopefully, this first point, before we get to all the contention in just a minute, which is why you guys showed up, hopefully this first point helps us to understand that the word election, the word chosen, is a Bible word, and it shouldn't be a trigger word. You guys know what trigger words are, right? Like if you're a big-time Seahawks fan and I say Patriots, you're twitching, you're yelling, you're screaming, you're justifying, right? What I want, because I know that there are good, godly, God-fearing people whom I respect and who we all respect sitting in this room who fall on both sides of this issue. That's a good thing for a church. That's a positive thing for a church. We want to be respectful of all of the different positions. This is not about two positions. This is really about this whole continuum of different positions where people fall out. And while I will fall out on a specific position, I want us to see that this isn't a trigger word or a trigger issue. That the idea of election is something that Christians have believed and held to for a long time from both sides. Okay? Where the contention begins to come in is in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2, as well as some other passages we'll look at. But 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2 says this: according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. That word foreknowledge has caused centuries of debate amongst Christians as to what election is all about. So I'll give you the second facet of election, according to my understanding of Scripture. And then I believe that the truth of election is biblical. The basis of election is unconditional. This is where there will be different views and different opinions and different beliefs. And so I want to, again, I want to work hard to try to do the best that I can to give credence to both sides. I don't want to be one of those theologians that draws a straw man out of the other side and then just knocks that down, okay? Because Jerry Pratt will tell you, there are lots of people who debate this who are a lot smarter than me, right, Jerry? Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. Yes. And you can get a good arguer on one side to make someone else look silly, and just because they're smart doesn't mean they're right. So what I want to do is try to help us just to see some of the basics for those of us who maybe even haven't seen this before. So when we talk about election, there are kind of two major sides that people will fall out on. One would be the conditional election side. If you're writing notes, put that on one side of the paper. Conditional election side. The other side would be called an unconditional election view. Conditional election view would interpret the word foreknew here in 1 Peter, along with some other places, as meaning prior information. So when it says, according to the foreknowledge of God, someone who believes in conditional election would say that foreknew means that God had prior knowledge. The argument goes like this, that God looked down through God the Father in eternity past, looked down through the corridors of time. He saw those who would believe. He saw those who would have faith. And he elected those people to salvation. You see, there's a foreknowing. There's a prior information that he's seeing. Those who would fall more on the unconditional election side would say that foreknowledge, prognosis, the Greek word, and the cognates of that, that means, that foreknew means predetermined. Predetermination. another way to think through this question is this, and I'm going to say it twice because I think it's really important. The conditional side, the way you think through this question would be, did God react based on what he knew you would do? Conditional side. Or did God initiate based on what he knew he would do? I understand in saying that, that leans a little bit in one direction. But as you think about how you interpret the idea of foreknowledge, prior information, if God looked down through the corridors of time, he saw that you would have faith, he saw that you would believe, and so then he chose and elected you. Did God react based on what he knew you would do? Or God predetermined, the unconditional election side, did he initiate based on what he knew he would do? He initiated a relationship with you. Those are the two sides. We'll talk about the history in just a minute and all of those things, but that's a very general synthesis of the conditional election side versus the unconditional election side. And just so that we're kind of on the same page, that when we talk about Arminian theology, that would be a conditional election side. Calvinistic theology, that would be an unconditional election side. Okay? Again, sometimes it's really hard for us to take those labels that we've grown up with, and that there's been a lot of just vitriolic rhetoric preached from different pulpits against one side or against the other, and you couldn't love Jesus and you couldn't believe the Bible if you took that position. I want us to be really careful with that. Okay? That's why sometimes it's important for us to think about it from a scripture point of view rather than from a theological construct kind of view. So conditional election and unconditional election, and here are at least three of the key texts. This word foreknowledge is used several times in the New Testament. Here are a few that are important. Acts 2:23 helps us maybe to see and understand how God looks at eternity in terms of all of time. This Jesus, delivered up, again, remember who's giving this sermon, by the way? This Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. What he's saying is, in implicating these religious leaders for being the people who crucified Jesus, is he's saying that God had a definite plan, and he had that plan from eternity past. What I don't believe that this text is teaching is that God the Father from eternity past had prior knowledge, that he just knew from eternity past that was going to happen, and he passively knew and passively understood that. And so that's what foreknowledge means here, because it says that God had a definite plan and a definite foreknowledge, a predetermination. And so you can see the word foreknowledge used in this context for predetermination, not just prior information. A definitive passage on this idea throws another important word in for us, is Romans 8:29. It says, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. Those who believe in conditional election would look at this and say, see, he looked, he saw, he knew, and then he predestined. He marked out ahead of time for them to be conformed. Unconditional election advocates would say, no. He predetermined to have a relationship with them. There's a lot of semantics that go on in the original language with this word, and where theologians say this is a relational word. This is not just about knowing facts, but this is about knowing people. And so when it's used not only in the New Testament, but outside of the New Testament, that it's not just about someone knowing facts about things when they foreknow, when prognosis happens, that they're not just knowing prior information, but it's actually a relational word where there's a predetermination to pursue relationship. So you read that in Romans 8:29, and then in 1 Peter 1:20, just a few verses from where we're at today, I think this is again important because it talks about Jesus and helping us to understand how foreknowledge is used. He, Jesus, was foreknown before the foundation of the world, was made manifest in the last times. And what Peter is getting across in these words, in using foreknowledge, was, again, not that God passively just knew something that was going to happen, not of his own volition, but that God had predetermined the atoning work of Jesus before the foundation of the world. And so Jesus was not just prior information for God, but Jesus and the work, the atoning work of Jesus, was predetermination by God before the foundation of the world. Some of those texts help us to get a view and help us to get an idea of how this concept of foreknowledge is used in Scripture. As I've said, there are generally two camps that people fall into here, the Arminian camp or the Calvin camp. And the first thing I want to say about that is maybe you've defined or identified yourself in the Arminian camp or in the Calvin camp before, and maybe you've looked at the people on the other side as the enemy before. At the end here, I want to spend some time talking about maybe why that shouldn't be the case, but I want you to realize that this didn't start with these guys as reformers in the 16th, 17th century, right? What's interesting is if you study church history and you read church history, for about the first four centuries of the Christian church after Christ, for about the first four centuries, you don't really hear anybody or read of anybody talking about unconditional election. You don't hear people arguing what I'm arguing today, actually. Most of the time, they argued for conditional election. Those early church followers, and you read them and you think, oh, wow, the early guys really understood foreknowledge as Jesus, as God just kind of looked down through time and foreknew. But what is often not taught in regard to that is that for the first four centuries of the church, what the church fathers were battling against was a group called the Gnostics and another group called the Stoics, who taught pagan determinism. They taught pagan fatalism. We have no control, we have no ability, we have no anything, there's no God, there's none of that. And this is a grossly oversimplified understanding of these things. But again, that everything was out of our hands, and so we just might as well do whatever we want and live however we want. And it's just fatalistic and it's deterministic. And so those theologians said, no, wait a minute. Man does have free will. Man does have the ability to choose. Man does. And so the idea of conditional election with the early church fathers was a way of combating something else. And so some would argue and say, well, this never showed up till Augustine, right? That this idea of unconditional election never showed up till Augustine. Oftentimes, the people who say that don't realize that we didn't even have a full list of the New Testament books until roughly the same time, but we still believe in them. Many of these same people hold to a dispensational view of theology, and by the way, that wasn't articulated until the 1800s. So if we're going to use that argument in one place, we better make sure that we use it through all places. Because what happened in church history is that about the early 5th century, a man named Pelagius came along. And Pelagius was a theologian, and he started to talk about human free will. And he talked about human free will in a way that made people feel really, some people feel really uncomfortable. Pelagius actually said, there's no such thing as original sin. That when your kids were born, they were born without a sin nature. That they were born basically good, and they were born basically okay, and everything was fine. That they didn't have a sin nature, and there was no original sin. And that human free will is ultimate. Councils called Pelagianism a heresy. But what happened in response to Pelagius and his teaching on human free will, a man that many of us know and love named Augustine came along. And Augustine is the first person to articulate unconditional election to say, no. Life is not just about human free will and choice as we read Scripture. It says a lot more than that. Augustine countered Pelagius with this idea of unconditional election. And like so many other areas of our theology, this is how we come to an understanding of Scripture and an understanding of theology, is that it gets worked out over time, and then large groups of people come together and test the theological accuracy of this. And that's what happened at some of the early church councils as well. This Pelagianism idea is heretical, and that what Augustine is teaching falls within the bounds of orthodoxy. So then you fast forward about 1,000 years of church history, and that's where Team Arminius and Team Calvin come into play. And Arminius was actually a reformed theologian, and he started to teach some of these ideas of human free will and less than total depravity. And Arminius actually started the fight. Some of us don't realize that, but Team Arminius and Arminius and his followers, they published what were called the Five Remonstrances. Right? I hope so. Right? And these 5 points were their beliefs in relation to this idea of human depravity and the extent of human depravity and the conditionality of election and the resistibility of grace and these kinds of things. And so they came out with their 5 points. And then there was another team with cool beards and sweet hats. And they said, I'm reading scripture and I'm hearing what you're saying and I'm not sure, I'm not buying it. And out of that, Team Calvin, as a response to the five remonstrances, out of a response to that, Team Calvin came up with what? Tulip, right? The 5 points of Calvinism, among which are total depravity and unconditional election. And so the 5 points of Calvinism were a debate against something that had come out prior to that. Well, wouldn't you know it, the battle continues. Can you believe it? The battle continues even today. And so what you end up with today is you end up with the classic Arminians, and then you end up, I don't know if you knew this, but John Wesley was an Arminian, right? And so you end up with that Arminian camp, and if you came out of a Methodist kind of background, very strong Arminian background, you get what I said, the Amaraldian or Amaraldian position, which is essentially a four-point Calvinist position. People are really torn on that limited atonement thing. We're not even going to get into that today. You can blog about it later, okay? But you have that position. You have what is known as Reformed theology or five-point Calvinism, and then you have what we call Jerk for Jesus theology or Hyper-Calvinism. And those, again, we'll talk about how those people react again in a minute. But those are kind of the ways that this continues to pull out. Here's what's really important for you to understand today as we all stand here together. All of those positions have traditionally been viewed since the time of the Reformation till now. All of those positions are considered by the church within, not just this church, but the Big C church, within the bounds of Christian orthodoxy. Everybody do this. Like, I agree, okay? Because there are those who are like, no, they're not. No, they actually have. I know that there are, you know, people kind of out on the fringes of each side. Here's the problem, too. This isn't in the notes, so who knows how it'll go. But we as Baptists, like, we can't figure ourselves out on this one, okay? You've got Presbyterians that hold pretty strong and Lutherans that have been pretty strong in where they're at. And you have Methodists who have stayed pretty strong in where they're at. Baptists split over this like we split over everything else, including the color of the carpet and what we're serving at the potluck. You had the General Baptists that were hardcore. Okay, I grew up in an independent fundamental Baptist movement. They were strong. Make sure that you have an altar call every Sunday, 8 verses of Just As I Am, etc., etc., etc. Why? Because it was an Arminian position, and if I preach hard enough and play the music well enough, then maybe your human free will respond, right? So there have been Baptists in that camp, and then you've got Spurgeon and his Reformed Baptist crew, right? And then you've got even everywhere in between, and so as Baptists, like, we're just confused. But that shouldn't surprise any of us, should it? I want to talk about it. Why do I believe that unconditional election is the biblical position? I think that's what is fair for me to share with you. Why do I fall where I fall on this? And again, I respect, and I know that there are good people that fall on both sides. I am not a hyper-Calvinist. I'm not an anti-Arminian. I try not to use either of those terms. But I would say that as I read Scripture, I lean toward the side of unconditional election. Jordan and I haven't even talked about this a whole lot, so I'm not even 100% sure that we're in full agreement on this. But I'll outline for you now why I am where I am, and then we can discuss it later. Number one, the first reason I believe unconditional election is the biblical position is because I believe that dead means dead. Ephesians chapter 2. And we're going to look at some verses. You can turn there if you want to. They're not going to be on the screen because I'm going to read maybe a couple more extended passages. But I believe that when Scripture says dead, it means dead, spiritually dead. Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 1. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air. The spirit is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we also once lived in the passions of our flesh. You say, well, wait, it says lived, right? We're talking about spiritual death while we're physically alive. Among whom we once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and we were by nature, by what? By nature, children of wrath. Just like the rest of mankind. But God. The most important words in relation to this whole argument. But who? But God. Being rich in mercy. Why? Because of the great love with which he loved us. Because God desires to have the relationship with us. Verse 5, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive. Together with Christ, by grace, you have been saved. That passage right there, and I'll even look at a couple more, but just is filled with the idea of total human depravity. This isn't about you're dead and God wakes you up or regenerates you enough that you now have a choice whether to do it or not. This is about God saying, no, you are dead, and everything that makes you alive, not just able to respond to God, but makes you respond to God because it makes you alive, everything about that is related to God, not to you. Because dead means dead. Romans chapter 3, verse 10. Romans 3, 10 says, as it is written, none is righteous. No, not one. No one understands. No one. All have turned aside. Together they become worthless. No one does good, not even one. I'll continue and read Romans chapter 9. Romans chapter 9, verses 14 through 16. And in Romans 9 through 11, Paul is like really getting after this whole idea of election. Romans 9:14. What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? That's the primary objection that people raise related to unconditional election. How could God be just? Paul answers it. Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. He says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. Verse 16. It depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. I can't read those texts and see anything other than total human depravity and complete human inability to respond. And again, to be fair, I understand that my Arminian friends would have an answer for every one of those verses and have a different response for each of those verses. But as I read Scripture, dead means dead. Depraved means depraved. Inability to respond on my own means inability to respond. I talk in a minute about why this doctrine is important. This has everything to do with how I respond to the Lord. The second reason that I believe that unconditional election is the biblical position comes from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, and you probably don't even need to turn there. For by grace you have been saved through faith. It's not your own doing, it's the gift of God. Not a result of works, so that no one may boast. Again, I understand that there are various interpretations of this from different groups. To me, when I study out, and I have, I've dug in and studied out the conditional election view, it just really sounds like it's getting really close to works-based salvation for me. I don't mean that as an accusation for someone who would believe that. But if God looks down through the corridors of time and sees that I'm going to respond, and then he reacts based on something that I'm going to do rather than initiating based on something he knew he would do, it's hard for me to justify that with, for by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, for the glory of God alone, which we hear about from Scripture alone, the five solas of the Reformation, right? So again, for me, that is why it's important, because I think Scripture teaches grace and grace alone. The fourth reason, and these last two are more maybe philosophical than scriptural, but the fourth reason for me is what's called doxological intensity, which means I believe that unconditional election puts all of the focus and all of the glory and all of the spotlight on God. Because if God is doing, and that's what Romans chapter 11, that great doxology, for from him and through him and to him are all things, to him be glory forevermore. That actually comes right at the end of Paul spending three chapters talking about this idea of unconditional, in my view, unconditional election. And it puts all the spotlight and all the glory on God, not on God kind of saying like, if you'll just respond to me. But it puts all the glory on God and all the focus on God. And so for me, doxological intensity is a reason for me to believe unconditional election. And I'll tell you the fourth reason is this. As I've read Scripture and as I've studied it and as I've tried to look at both positions and I've tried to lay out both positions, and I grew up in one camp. And I went to school in a slightly different camp. And I've continued to learn and grow and try to think. Here's the truth. I don't want to land where I've landed. I wish I could say the basis of election is conditional. Just from a human standpoint, just for me, I wish I could say that like election is based on God looked down through the corridors of time and he thought, I want him on my kickball team, right? Like I would really rather land on a conditional side. And I've studied it, even trying to go that way. And I just keep getting pulled back. And theological integrity my life demands that I hold an unconditional election view. So for me, those two biblical views and two more philosophical views are why I hold to unconditional election. Again, I'd love to have conversation with you, okay? Now, God did foreordain before the foundation of the world that me and Lindsay and the girls are going to go on a couple days vacation here as soon as we get done with this. So your disagreements with this can go to Pastor Lauren. Lauren@PuyallupBaptist.org. It was predestined before the foundation of the world. You can't argue with it. I'll say a few things about how we deal with this. And now you're all realizing, oh, that's why we're only doing two today. Right. I'm writing the sermon. I'm like, we can get all five in. No, we can't. A couple of things now about how we handle the different positions we might. Number one, that this is an important doctrine, okay? There's a minimalist approach to theology. It's called theological minimalism, okay? That says we just need to get like the three or four like really huge big things right, and the rest, none of the rest of it matters. So let's just make sure that like Jesus is God. God is Trinitarian. Jesus is God. The Bible hopefully is like the inspired word of God, and the rest of it is, okay? We do not ascribe to theological minimalism. This is an important doctrine. It affects our understanding of God's role and man's role in salvation. I mean, this is a big deal. It affects how I open the Bible and how I read all of these different passages. So it affects what you teach your kids. It affects how you teach a Sunday school class. It affects all of the ways that you open and read and understand God's work in the New Testament. And I believe that it really affects the way that you view the work of God in salvation history, right? This is an important doctrine. It affects the way that you pray. It affects the way that you witness to other people. And it most certainly affects the way that you worship God. How you fall out on election is important. But But number two, this is not an essential doctrine. It is not an essential doctrine. So the opposite of theological minimalism is theological sectarianism. And they take everything, put it in one big bucket, and say, this is all stuff that we should split over. How many angels can you fit on the head of a pin? That goes right in there with the deity of Jesus. Put it all in there, right? So by saying that this is not an essential doctrine, I would say that Arminians and Calvinists, along with Arminius and Calvin, will both be in heaven. At least the ones that God predestined to be there before the foundation of the world. No, I'm kidding. But those of us who hold different views on this, we're going to be together in heaven. And Calvin and Arminius, they got it figured out already, right? I wish they'd email us. But they know. And there's a pretty good chance that the Lord sat them both down and was like, okay, here's where you really went wrong, and here's where you went wrong, right? That's important perspective for us to understand that this is an important doctrine, but it's not salvific. You know what I mean? It's not. Our salvation is not based on this. You don't get saved based on whether you're Calvinist, Arminian, unconditional election, conditional election. This is a secondary or a tertiary kind of doctrine. And the third thing I think it's important to say, too, is at this time, in this cultural moment in the history of the church, especially in America, I don't believe that this is an urgent doctrine. Okay? I think in our current culture, there are much bigger things for Christians to fight over than this election thing. As a matter of fact, if you look at the 5th century and you look at the time of the Reformation, those two time periods, soteriology, the doctrine of salvation, was a really big deal. They were trying to figure it out and get it right, and Augustine and Pelagius, they were wrestling back and forth about trying to get this right, and obviously the Reformers were reacting against some really bad things that were happening in the Catholic Church, and soteriology was really important in those times. Right now, I think that things like even the authority of Scripture or the truthfulness of the Bible, the fact that there even is a God, those are probably the things that we should spend more time arguing about. And what happens if we're over here arguing unconditional versus conditional, and that's not really where the battle is? It's like you're having a skirmish over here somewhere, and the real battle is on a completely different continent, right? And so to provide that context is important, that it is an important doctrine, but it's not an essential doctrine, and it's not an urgent doctrine. We know that both sides have major issues to deal with. If you're part of the conditional election group, the biggest questions are going to be, what do you do about the sovereignty of God? What do you do about the depravity of man? If you're part of the unconditional election crew, the question is going to be the justice of God. Like, that's not fair. So both teams have to answer some important questions, and there's been some serious accusations leveled against both groups as well as it regards pride. If you're a conditional election person, does that lead to pride, or does that lead to despair if you just can't make it? What about worship? Worshiping a God that just chose you because he was reacting to you, right? But then on the other side, on the unconditional side, they would say, well, what about evangelism? What about prayer? Doesn't it affect all of those things? So how we hold these doctrines matters. I want you to be informed about this, okay? I don't want you to think, oh, this is one of those things I just can't understand. That's what the pastors, I can't understand it. I want you to be informed. Why I started with what the Bible says is because at least if you can say, well, I know that the Bible says these things about it, then that's a win. To be informed about it. I also want you to be reasoned and rational, okay? People often hold theological positions and hold them with intensity, not based on rationality, but on personality. Can I say that again? Oftentimes people hold the positions that they hold, not because they've thought through it and studied through it and dug through it and all of those things, but they hold those positions because it just makes sense to them because of, like, their personality or our emotions. Rational, and then be reasonable and be loving. We should not be having fights over this. I don't think that this church does, but Christians shouldn't be having fights and battles and wars. People shouldn't be splitting churches over this issue, okay? there are going to be some churches that are going to lean in one direction and other churches that lean in another direction. But that doesn't have to be us. We can hold what we hold with love. We can hold what we hold, understanding that there is an other side. And guess what? There are people smarter than any of us that hold both sides, and that should bring some humility to the table. So again, I hope that some of this has been helpful in like helping you maybe broaden your understanding of this doctrine and of this idea. We're going to talk about the last three points, which come right from this text next week. Grow in that together. I would say this in closing, if you would like more resources on studying this, come and talk with me about it. I'd love to give you some resources. Lauren probably has some as well. Be careful if you just Google it, okay? This is one of those ones. You want to be careful if you just Google it because you're going to find a lot of crazy stuff out there. So maybe run some of those resources and stuff that you read and people that you like to listen to. Maybe run those through one of us. We'd love to, again, give you some resources. And my favorite resources aren't the ones that just agree with me, but the ones that present both sides and allow you to think through those issues. Okay? Hopefully we can be of help. Going to have you stand. We're going to close in prayer. And remember, if you're part of that music meeting, we'll be right in the fellowship hall. God, thank you that I can stand here and stand behind your word. Thank you on even maybe controversial issues that we can take an approach to them that shows your greatness and your goodness and shows your glory. God, it shows how you have been gracious to us in salvation. And what we all agree on here, or any of us who are Christians, is that we are grateful for what you have done for us. God, that application of salvation has made us new, has changed our lives, has changed our hearts. God, it has continued to help us to change our lives and change our hearts. So I pray that we would continue to focus on the greatness of who you are and the goodness of what you've done for us in Christ. Of your word who are rational and thoughtful. And God, I pray that you would help us to be reasonable and be loving with people who differ from us on theological issues. Thank you for the opportunity to open your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys. Have a good week.